Welcome everybody. It's my distinct pleasure to be chairing, co-chairing this doctoral forum with Joyce here. This is one of the first activity in the doctoral forum, a very exciting panel with great experts and friends who span, industry, academia, and national labs, who are very gracious with their time and are going to share their experiences from, surviving and succeeding in a PhD and what comes beyond, and their very unique and interesting insights. So without further ado, I would like to thank everybody for being here, and especially the panelists. I also would like to give special thanks to the National Science Foundation for supporting a lot of the activities, including student registrations. And let's start. So let me just give you a brief format of the panel. So for the first hour, roughly, each panelist will share their experience with a short talk and give general advice. At this time, feel free to record your questions. You can type them on the chat. And then after everybody's finished, then we can have a Q&A session with the audience. So if you want to ask your question, I'm happy to relay it if you typed it on the chat, but you can also use the raise hand function, and we can call your name out and you can ask your question. And then for whoever is available and able to stay from the panelists, I would kindly ask you to move to gather.town, which is a really nice kind of Super Mario Zelda kind of world where we can kind of have a more informal meet and greet session with the students. We can ask a little bit more questions and so on. So, and last but not least, tomorrow we have a very exciting poster session with all the doctoral students that will be split into pieces. Runs at the same time as the forum, but tomorrow, and there will be a judging session, and then the judges are listed here. So I will send out the split into two different sessions again to everyone to remind, and I will also post it in the VFairs chat so that everybody is aware of the splitting into two sessions. And now I'm going to stop talking and invite Pravi, who will, so the order is going to be this alphabetical in, last name. So Pravi to kick it off. All right. So.
All right. Hi, everyone. So I know Neil, I know Pagelis. Pagelis is my co-advisor in grad school. And Ramki, who's another panelist, is my postdoc mentor, who we both work at this, and he's my line manager now at the lab. So my name is Pravi. I graduated from my PhD in 2018, in the summer of 2018. So I know Neil because it's an academic network. Neil and Vagelis were grad students. So I, with working with Vagelis and my advisor also, like Mihalis, I had an inbuilt set of people, and it's so fun to be here on the same stage. So I came from India for grad school. I have my master's and my undergrad in India. And when I was an undergrad student, unlike a lot of people who I've met here, American people who met here, I did not have any experience with research. And I was doing my master's, and I had this opportunity to go to Prague for a year to work in this problem of theoretical computer science of subsumption checks and identifying how do you find the best way. This was 12 years ago, so I don't remember it exactly well, but I really enjoyed the process of like self-learning and like, so you can guide your own thing. Nobody's going to give exams on something that you have learned. So I really enjoyed that process of self-learning and guiding your own thing, which is generally my style of learning. So, which is why I'm like, oh yeah, I think I'm going to go for a PhD. And my parents were like, that's a 5 to 6 year commitment. It's like, are you sure about that? Like, this was India. So like my parents are like, that's a 5 to 6 year commitment. Are you sure about it? Yeah, I'm sure. And then I applied to Germany. And then I also applied to the US. And so I met my advisor, Mihalis Falutsis, who at the University of New Mexico at the time. And then he moved to UC Riverside, which is where I met Vagelis back in 2016. So I have my experience of 3 years in University of New Mexico and 3 years at UC Riverside, which gave me so many different perspectives, because when I worked at UNM, there were lots of national labs around, Sandia and Los Alamos, which are central to a lot of PhD students, where a lot of PhD students would get their PhD from UNM and go to these national labs. So, and then I came to UC Riverside, which is where a lot of focus on industry was, and everyone I met there had some kind of industry experience, which I did not have at that point. So anyway, it's been a very interesting journey, like having my PhD in two different places and two advisors. Been fun. So one of the things I generally wanted to start off was by the way, I was reading a thesis yesterday. So on the thesis, it said it takes a village to raise a PhD student. And I really, really like that. And I wanted to bring that up. So yeah, in the acknowledgement. So I'll just say that out loud. Yeah. So one of the things I wanted to talk about was what advice, because I'm a fairly new graduate, compared to here, like a couple of years ago. So, and I still feel like, oh my God, I don't know what I'm doing, at least in the lab. And I'm like, these people are so smart. What am I doing here? Sometimes I think that to myself. But that's part of being in research, or that's part of learning. And one of the things I thought about, like I want to talk about, is what advice would I give to my PhD, past PhD self, is one of the main things was, don't be afraid to ask for help. I grew up in a place where there was lots of comparison. My mom was a teacher, so we always like, did you see that person studying so much better, like, or did you see that, or did you, there was always so much comparison growing up. So I always felt like I had to have a lot of things figured out. But when I came to the US, like especially working with advisors Vagalis and Mihalis, both of them were very informal in their approach, where they simply wanted to know or develop my capability as how I should be learning, which is what we do in our PhD, where we are basically provided tools on how to get started or get to learn. So I really did not start actually asking people for help until like almost a year into my PhD. And I only realized that because of Vagalis and Neil here. So Neil introduced me to a mentor at Lawrence Livermore, and because Vagalis asked him, and I'm like, I cannot believe that he just sent an email on my behalf. He does not even know me. And that's how I thought to myself. And then I came back from my internship at Lawrence Livermore, and I really loved the data there. There was lots of high dimensional data. And I was just learning about tensor decompositions at this point. And I'm like, I came back and I started learning about tensors. I'm like, what a great way to apply to a lot of tensors to a lot of high dimensional problems at the lab, because it's hard to find high dimensional data, the kind of rich high dimensional data or like tensor data that we find at national labs outside, like in academia, because the way I work at the lab is we are able to connect a lot of computer science solutions to domain problems. Domain problems include like material sciences or nuclear sciences, lots of high dimensional data. So one of the main things I've learned from that experience is like, what a great person, like he actually just sent an email on my behalf. So I should simply ask people for help and they're willing to help. And since then, one of the things, like the worst thing that can happen if I ask for help is somebody can say no or not respond. And that's not the worst thing that can happen. So if I feel like donning, I'll simply ask for help. That's one of the first things. And the second thing I also did not think was, because there was just so much comparison in 6 years of your life, basically you're putting into grad school, is I did not think I was doing a good enough job, like because everyone had papers in the KDD and all of this. And it's a very competitive venue. It's like a 9% acceptance rate. And I really always wanted to have a paper at KDD. And I did not. And I thought, like, I don't think I'm doing a good enough job. I don't know whether I'm good enough. And I thought to myself, but one of the things I would go back and tell myself is like, I'm doing better than I think I was doing. That's definitely because I only realized 2 years after my PhD that PhD is not like a be-all, end-all thing. Your thesis is not who you are. I mean, it might be for some people, but that's how I've learned about myself, because it's basically a set of tools, and I'm not able to put everything I have learned on paper. That's not what an employer or somebody who's interviewing with me will see. I'm not able to put everything. I used to be terrified of public speaking until like 2015. But also Vagalis assures me that I'm actually a good, I don't look that I'm terrified, but I actually am. But it's also because of my extrovert self. So one of the things I've learned is you cannot put everything on paper, but just because you're not put on paper does not mean you haven't learned something. So that's something. And then third thing is to self-advocate. If you have done something, don't undermine yourself by saying, I mean, this, maybe it's a woman thing, or I don't want to make that a gender thing, but it's also like me, I've always said, I don't think that's a good enough paper. I don't think that's a good enough work. I don't think that should have been published. I used to tell myself, at least in the beginning. But then that's also you having too many high standards, or you being judging yourself critically. And it's also good to have standards, but it's also like, be kind to yourself, because it's a 6-year journey, because of 5 to 6 year journey. So self-advocate for yourself, speak about your work. Don't put yourself down by saying that I could have done it better. But always, if you could have done it better, this is then simply say, this is my future work. This is what I plan on doing that, or this is how I plan on improving that. And always self-advocate and don't talk yourself down. So those are the three big things. And one of the things that was how did I decide on being what I do? I'm a staff scientist at ORLAN now, and which is not as so. I'm the kind of person. So for example, I've met people in my grad school who knew they wanted to be professors, who knew where they wanted to be, and I'm not that person. I've taken decisions based on, hey, this sounds cool, so I'm going to do this. This sounds cool, I'm going to do this. So I've been that person who's taken paths what felt right at that particular time. So that's just how I am as a person. So I went down the path of how I just thought about, what do I want to do in the future? And I thought about, like, what do I want my daily life to be like? And I pretty much knew that tenure track would not be for me, because every time I saw the professors, it was always like, that sounds like an all-consuming job, and I don't want to be that. I want to have a life, and a job is part of my life. And I don't know. It's also something that has to come from inside, which I don't think I have that. There's a life, and there's so many hobbies, and then there's a lot of that for me. So I don't know. It's maybe an outsider perspective of not being a tenure track professor, but that's how I thought about it. So I knew what I did not want to do. Basically, by eliminating what I did not want to do, I came down to the industry. But I also knew that I wanted to do research, because I just got introduced to some cool new things. And I knew I wanted to pursue some things more and learn. But also going to industry, I did not, and this was that, at that time. I knew when if I went to industry, went for like an industry position, I knew I would not be doing as much research, because publishing papers is not on the forefront of your job description. So I thought I came for a postdoctoral and then became staff a year later. So I thought this was a good balance between the two things, where I would be able to still do research, learn new things, and publishing. And ORL is a science-based lab. We are supported mainly by the Department of Science. So we have a lot of open research going on. So that I thought that was a good compromise between doing research versus like not having the stress of being at in your track and still learning in your everyday life. So that's one thing. And one of the things, okay, I wanted to just mention this as a point. One of the things I've definitely learned since finishing my PhD is PhD is simply a set of tools. It's not, like I said, you can have 20 papers, and I've seen a lot of people have 20 papers by the time they graduate, which I was not one of them. I had like 5 or 6. So I've seen folks do that, but I've since graduating, I thought to myself, I was like, what have I really learned? And what I learned is, if you give me a topic or if you give me a paper, when I started my PhD back in 2013, 2012, I would take about 2 to 3 hours to read a paper and to come up with pros and cons in detail. Now, if you give me a paper, I'm able to review it like maybe in an hour and a half if it's a very dense paper. If it's an easy paper, like an hour. So yeah, that's a good compromise between, like, so, you know, coming down by 3 hours to like 30 minutes to an hour is not bad in the 5 to 6 year period. So one of the things is PhD is simply a set of tools for us to move forward, to think more analytically. And every time I think to myself, I cannot believe that that's such a cool idea, that is very cool. And I've also learned all of your publication, all of the cool things are 25% like, you know, ideas or how smart some person is, and 75% work. So it's and the more you go along, the more you learn, the better you'll get. And there's just no comparison with other people. And it's just how you were 6 months ago to how you are now. So that's my 2 cents.
Thank you so much, Pravi. Now, Ramki, would you like to go next?
Thank you, Agnes. Pravid, that's a great start. Thanks for giving me this opportunity. Initially, I thought like I will not do it over presentation, but when Agnes asked that, I felt that's the right question too. So what does it take for someone to show right after PhD, or what will they show, right? I think this can be an example for that. So I always have this deck. This is my 2020 deck. I have not made a 2021. So some statistics will be slightly older, but you can think some counts would have gone up. That's it. Okay, so let me share my screen. So I would like to split this 10 minutes into three parts. So on the first part, I want to talk about my journey. And in the second part, the life during exit strategy, and there is a PhD to the job. And then third part is where am I now and what am I planning to do? That is, what did I realize? Right, so that's what I will split this into three portions. Okay, so I had 11 years of experience at IBM prior to starting my PhD across three different divisions at IBM. Like I started as a product engineer for a networking software at IBM. It's a product that sits in between mainframe and the internet world. And then I moved on to IBM Research, worked there for 3 years. In fact, Professor Yan Liu and me overlapped a bit. I was working with Amol Goding and Anju Kambadur, but both of us were in the same group of Siddharthi. And then I started my PhD in 2011 at Georgia Tech. I applied to only five colleges. I decided that if I'm not getting it, I'm not doing it, right? I already had a family, I had a kid, and a lot of things will run in your mind, right? Like, is it a good decision? Do you want to do it? Is this what you want to do? All these questions will run. It's a huge commitment, 5 years commitment, everything. But I got Georgia Tech, one of the five colleges that I applied. And then that told me, okay, maybe it's in your destiny to do it. Right? So survived with the family with $2,300, of which $800 went for apartment rent and $1,000 went for your insurance. So you can think, right? But I was not alone in the campus. When I looked at it, I saw that there are people with two kids, and many people from China come as married couples. So I was not alone. That gave me a good confidence. And life went on. And as usual, many ups and downs during PhD, qualifiers, proposal, many things will come. But I was very focused on what I wanted to do. And I got out in 4.5 years. Right. So, when you are exiting from your PhD, the four choices that lie in front of you are either you can take up a lab job, okay, industry labs like IBM Research, Facebook Research, any of those things. Or you can join lab like Oak Ridge National Lab. There are many labs, NASA lab, Fermi lab, many labs that you can join. Or you can think about joining academics, or you can do your own startup, right? All four are equally likely to happen. Okay, so you have to think there is the problem that you dealt in your research is something you know that is useful to the society, and you may be even tempted to do a startup. A classical example is Sergey and Larry of Google, right? So that's also equally likely to happen, right? So in fact, I know startups from Georgia Tech, many people did that. In fact, a company called a Pindrop Security came out from the Georgia Tech, okay? In Atlanta, right? So I think all of them are then how will you make the choice, right? So it's the nature of the problem and what that place does is different between them, right? In the case of industry, you are solving current people's problem, okay? The maximum time that you'll be given to solve a problem is 3 to 6 months. That's what you can think. In 6 months, whatever you are doing should hit the production. If you are not doing it, then you are not contributing to the organization, okay? And every company will solve in its own merit, its own problem. If you are interested in social network, go to Facebook. If you're interested in search and indexing, go to Google. If you are interested in enterprise problem, go to IBM. Every company solve its own problem, and that's what you are going to contribute to, right? In the case of lab, we work on scientific and engineering problems. That is neutron scattering experiments. What is going inside a material, okay? How does disease spread, okay? What will happen during the global warming? Which are all the places that it's going to get immersed, okay? You want to do simulation, okay? You want to find drugs for COVID, okay? Run simulation for finding drugs for COVID. If you are having this kind of an inclination, then lab is a great place. Okay, in the case of academic, you are laying foundation towards opening up a new avenue or a new problem that you want to solve. Okay, that's what you can think about as an academic place. And in the case of startup, you have done a research and you feel it's a compelling problem that you want to take it to people's life, then you get into the startup. So sit back and think, what do you want to solve, right? For example, if your interest is to work on scientific problems, don't join industry. That's not the right place. Okay. And okay, so now that I have made a decision, now I have joined, right? How will I know whether my decision is right or not? That will be the next question. Okay. For that, I keep 3 metrics. Okay. So the first metric is performance, okay? Are you doing good? Second thing is productivity. Every day, that is from last year, if you are able to do 8 publications, this year you must be able to do 10 publications. Think like that, okay? And then finally, are you learning something every day? Are you trying to solve the problem again and again? Or every day you are feeling stressed that it's a new domain, I cannot do it, okay? It's not an 8 to 10 hours job, it's becoming 12 to 14 hours job for me every day, right? So that's what learning every day. You most of the time, in any of the places that you choose, whether in academics, whether in industry, or in a lab, you will feel your PhD days were greener. Okay, that's the practical reality, okay? If you are feeling stressed now, then I'm just preparing you. It'll give you a slight ray of hope, right? That you are still in a good environment, right? So that's what you can think about it, right? And then the next point that I wanted to convey to you all is, in any of the places that you have joined till now, whether in your hometown, most of us will have humble beginning, okay? We are starting from a small hometown and kept on improving ourselves, right? So, but every time we would have been top in the place that wherever we have been, whether it is in your campus, whether it is in the school days or among your relatives, everything you would have been top. You would have been a top performer. You would have been in the top 1% of the total crowd. But when you join the workforce in any of these places, lab, academy, industry, all the people are the top 1%, right? So there is a very high probability that you are not in top 1% of the 1% group. Okay, so that's normal. Understand that life has bounds, okay? And then how will you know, am I doing better than others? It's temporal in characteristics. Okay, you are doing better now doesn't mean that you will do better tomorrow, or you are there is you didn't do bad in the past. Okay, so consider this as a temporal characteristic. Agree and accept that fact. Okay. And then the other philosophy, maybe I will touch it up after I run through my introduction. Okay, and then the, so let's go. So this is the life transition about myself, right? So I started with a humble beginning in a small hometown called Trichy in India. If you go to Google and search it, it's really a small, tiny place. Okay, all of us in this room would have come through that humble beginning. Okay, we would have struggled on PhD. All of us went out and we are moving our career, right? So that's what this entire slide talks about me. So currently what I'm doing, so any of my today's activity will fall in any one of these four buckets. If you talk about my current 1 hour, then I will say it is dedicated to the community. So I am postdoctoral and I'm talking with the community, right? Or I'll be talking with academic community, like still have working relation with Agelis, and I work with my Professor Hazen Park. We have every 1 hour meeting. I think Pravi is also doing the same thing. And I'm pretty sure most of us will continue doing that in the life. That is, you will keep talking with your professor on a regular basis, right? That's what we can fall under the academic. And then research impacts, that's what my work at ORNL. And finally, some code development. This is the tangible deliverable that as a computer scientist or in any discipline, there will be some tangible deliverables. You can think like Neil will be doing it. Pravi is doing it today. Everyone will have a tangible deliverable. So any hour in my 40 hours or 50 hours will fall into one of these four buckets. That's what I do every day. And where am I going? Okay, so this is my research goal right now. Distributed machine learning algorithms for scientific discoveries. That's the common platform for me, Vagelis, Professor Yan Liu. All of us intersect under this common theme. Okay, you can think like that, right? And working towards a DOE Early Career Award. I think everyone will be doing it in their early career, right? And what am I focusing on the next 2 years? Working with Professor Richard Duke on a course content for machine learning algorithms on HPC platforms. Right now, working on a book with Professor Vipin Kumar and Anuj Karpathne. And then professional body involvement, like early career awards and everything. That's what these things are happening right now. Okay. And what is the long term, like in 5 years from now, right? Working with academicians across different US region to nurture scientific or computational machine learning as a formal discipline, right? This is what I'm keeping it as a 5 year goal for me now, right? Computational machine learning should be a like school of computational sciences and engineering. There must be a school of computational machine learning, right? In many of the campuses. Can I move towards that? Is what I'm thinking as a long-term goal. And then initiating and contributing to specification benchmarks, etc. And this is my current team at Oak Ridge National Lab. And what we do, right? And this is our objective and vision. Like we work on distributed machine learning models and algorithms for scientific data on HPC platform. And our vision is achieving excellence for computing scientific ML models using scalable HPC algorithms, libraries, tools, and techniques. I think with this, I will stop my about me slide. Okay.
Thank you so much, Ramji.
I think I have overrun the time. I will end with this final thing. Okay. So life is a cycle. You have to understand that. When I started my career as an engineer at IBM, okay, they kept on telling me, you deliver things, you cannot think. Okay, you cannot do great things. That forced me to join research. Okay, I went into the research, started getting motivation at IBM Research. That's where I crossed bridges with Yan Liu and some of the people here. And that really, everyone mentioned, you don't have a PhD, you cannot drive research. Okay, I felt there's a small hindrance block. I can get a PhD, okay? So I joined PhD I did independent research. I'm getting research money now. There is money for conducting research and everything. Do you know the question that is asked to me now? All the work that you are doing is good only in papers. Can you touch people's life? What difference are you making into people's life? Right? This again falls into the ambit of engineering. So after 2 decades, okay, I realized that life is a cycle. Okay. So you will always be questioned. You will always be running. You will always be thinking, okay, if I do this, I'm good. I have done an achievement. I have moved my life. Never. There is always going to be a carrot in front of you and you are a rabbit chasing it. Just keep a wiser rat. Wiser carrot. That's it.
Awesome. Thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Thanks, Akhilas.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yen, would you like to go next?
Sure. Yeah. Let me share my screen. Just a second. Okay. Can everybody see the slide? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
All right, yeah. So first of all, thanks a lot for the organizers for the invitation. PhD mentor has always been my passion. So when they asked, I immediately said yes. A little bit of introduction of myself. I'm currently a professor in computer science department in University of Southern California. I'm also serving as the director of the Machine Learning Center here. So I'm just following Vasilis and Joyce's suggestion in terms of the flow of the slides. So hopefully it's okay. First, a little bit about my journey. So I get my bachelor about 20 years ago, and then I went to Carnegie Mellon for my PhD. Afterwards, then I spent about 3.5 years in IBM research. And afterwards, I joined USC. So basically, I'm a person who have switched between academia and industry and have enjoyed both. So I think that we have been given a list of the questions. I know probably this is more for discussion for later, but I have to probably leave before the start. So I just want to go over the questions. The first question is that if you could give your PhD student past self, what would that be? And since we're talking about 20 years ago, so my memory is a little bit vague. But based on my vague memory, this is what I'm thinking in terms of some of the life self-suggestions or advice to the students, and obviously to myself. If I can go back 20 years ago, that would be wonderful. So the first thing I would say that this is really the most wonderful time of your life. Really enjoy your life, enjoy doing research. Research is a lot of fun. And then I would say that talk to people when you do research. Research is not talking about you close the door and just trying to solve the hardest problem in the world. It's really about, you know, talking to people, identifying the problem and seeing what is the solution, talking to people again. And, you know, this is going to be certain research, certain research. And along the way, you are going to make a lot of friends, really cherish the relationship, cherish your friendship. And then the third thing I would say is that I know that as a PhD student, including myself, I was very much, I guess, pressured with the paper and publications. I think 20 years ago, things are much better. We just usually publish one paper per year. And I think at CMU, this is what is called as a really good student. Many people publish a paper 2 years and things like that. So we're less pressured, but even now I know that there's a lot of pressure, but I still think that we shouldn't focus on the numbers and really thinking out of the box, doing something really good, because in the end that people will only remember just one work or two work. It's very difficult for people to remember your 20 work. So I think one or two work will be something that you're really proud of. That'd be really good. And spending all your time, energy, all your love on that project, I think it will be paid off in the long term. And then And also another question comes in terms of how did you decide what you want to do after the PhD? I would like to say is that I actually don't know. And that is why I tried a few things before doing an internship. I don't like my internship. So I said, no, I don't want to go to industry. But you know, that once I finished my PhD, I have to choose between career versus, you know, having to live together with my current husband at that time, boyfriend. And then we decided to go to industry. I don't like it either. I tried it, and then I come back to academia after a few years. So I would say that, I mean, really don't pressure yourself to say, hey, I have to make a decision right now, or I'm going to make a decision at that time when I'm close to graduation. I would say that just try a few things before and after your PhD. I think one person's experience in academia or industry will vary significantly. It depends on which group you're in, which university you're in, who you talk to closely. So the experience could be totally different. I think you just have to try out and then decide. And also, I think the idea will change over the time, in the sense that that I think at the beginning, I like academia, but I feel like it's so much pressure. And later I like to join industry, but I don't like industry in the sense that you have to change your research career or research topic all the time. And then I go back to academia. Sometimes I was like, okay, academia, that we don't have the right resources to do the right research work. I think each side has their pros and cons. And try a few things, make a decision, and also just be truthful in the sense that you will know for any decision you make, that decision will be associated with some pros and cons. And as long as you know what they are and just embracing the opportunity and also enjoy, I think that's really important. And then the third question is, what mechanism did you develop to deal with harsh feedback and rejection? I think that's really hard for all PhD, and including even the top researchers. I think the reason why we choose PhD, because there's a selection bias, because we have been doing so well when we were elementary student, when we were a middle school student, and we're a college student, we're very confident. And also the feedback we got is that it's always positive. It's always like you are really the top of the class. I think that we tend to be like a population who get more positive feedback along the first, I guess, one third of our life. And then for the rest of our life, I think that it's really a transition stage where we quickly realize that there's still something that no matter how good you are, that you are going to get some negative feedback or rejections. And I think especially for female students, we feel very bad of being rejected for anything. Over the years, you know, that at the beginning, I got my paper rejected, I cried. And I was feeling so unhappy for a few days and stuff like that. I think by now I gradually develop a particular, I guess, systematic way to handle it. And the first thing is that when I saw the email came, and I was like, okay, all right, I'll check it out later. I have so many important things I need to do, leave it alone for a few days. And then also I would say that just to be positive and optimistic in the sense that, you know, that when we have papers rejected, that's not mean that the work is not good, probably it's just not ready. I personally have the experience that we got paper rejected from one conference and then get best paper award, actually in SDM. And I'm sure that a lot of us have similar experience. So I think one door shut for you, it means that many other doors are open for you. Just to be positive and optimistic. This is really just, you know, a person, I think this is just towards this particular subject, towards this particular proposal, towards this particular paper. It's not denying ourselves. It's not denying our research as a whole. And then when we look at the feedback, I would say the thinking from the reviewer's perspective. And I think when you switch perspective, then you quickly understand a lot of the criticism, where they come from. a lot of the time my students would say, oh, you know, the reviewers are so dumb. They don't look at our papers. I already mentioned that in line 536 to line 560, as specifically explained the questions, and they didn't even look at it. And I think that yes, you will get a lot of feedback like this, but when you look at the other perspective, it probably means that these are the really important point in the paper, and you want to stress it again and again so that reader, helping the readers and helping guiding the readers to understand, to find these topics, to help you to get their positive rating. If you don't help the readers, you're basically not doing a good job for yourself either. So if you look at from that perspective, maybe your view of all this criticism could be quite different, and you will change and make adjustment and getting a really good paper. And then I think lastly is really just accepting who you are. This is so hard. I know that we've been top A students and we've been, you know, top 1% all the time. But at the same time that there's just, you know, people that who cannot do everything. And I don't think there's anybody who can do anything. And therefore just accepting our weakness and also just improve on that. I think after I become a parent, I gradually even learn more from that, because for our own students, right, for our own child, we want the really best. And when your child or your student get denied, you feel like that's a slap on the face. But, you know, in the end, it's really just, you know, one incident or particular aspect of what it is. I think really just continue improving should be the right attitude, instead of just saying that, oh, I'm not good enough anymore. It's not like that, yeah. And then what resources were useful to me when I was doing my PhD? I would say that my advisor helping me a lot, other faculty that I work closely with, my office mates, even though they don't work in the same area, they cheer me up, my family. I think all of them actually are social with people. In the end, I think that people are really the best resources that you can use. Really cherish the friendship, building up the good relationship, thinking from others' perspective, be careful, right? I think you will enjoy the relationship. I think there is a TED Talk, right? Talking by, given by a Harvard University. They study what makes people happy. And they do all these surveys, they do all these different type of, you know, study over decades. And in the end, the conclusion is that a healthy relationship is what makes you happy. I think that's exactly, to the point that is, human are social animals. And in the end, I think having people to trust, to rely on, to give criticism to you is really something we should cherish. And I think probably these days that staying with friends, especially during COVID, is difficult, maybe good use of social media. I'm still trying to learn by myself. Hopefully that I can do better. But I think it's really a channel to really to just connecting people. I think that there's another question about how important was networking with peers and senior mentors to you? How were you able to manage to do it? I think I talked about a relationship just now. So I would say that, again, it's extremely important. But on the other side is that I don't think I do a really good job myself. As a young kid, I have very difficult and challenging talking to senior people. I think this is just culture-wise, that in Eastern culture, that senior people are gods, and well, you know, junior people are the little people that we all have to respect. Over the years, I also tried. Always comes into the play in terms of, you know, how to balance the career and life, and there are just many factors in there. I think I'm still improving, but based on my limited experience in there, I think there are two things I felt like is really important. It's extremely difficult to build a trust, but it's also very easy to disrupt a trust. So to do that, I would say that be prepared when opportunities knock at your door. That means that really trying to strengthen your skills at multifacets, right? And on the other side is that be responsible when you are assigned a job. I mean, I know there are a lot of service work right now, and even for PhD student, you have to start reviewing for papers. You can say I'm too busy, I can't do it anymore, but you know that, when, if you agree to do that, please submit your review in time. Please do your service work in time. And I mean, we have a lot of panelists and also our organizers have been so responsible, and that's how we build the trust. But on the other side, that if you didn't submit your review in time and you didn't, you know, do the thing that you agreed to, then sometimes that trust may be disrupted. I don't think it's like a one-time deal, but if you know, gradually we keep on doing that, possibly it's not really good. So I would say that really trying to be responsible and be reliable, be dependable. That's how, I think that's the really one important factor to manage the really good relationship with the peers and also with the senior mentors. And then I think the last question is about navigating the advisor-advisee relationship. And I think even when I was a student, I kind of feel like, oh, my advisor is a boss, or I feel like my manager is a manager, or some people feel like their manager is this ego person who always push the students trying to do their work, or many other students have other different type of feelings. But I think overall that it's really that we are in the same boat at the same time. And this particular ride is really a wonderful time in our life. So we really have to work towards the relationship, learning how to work together and be respectful, be dependable, and also, you know, be open-minded. I think then this will help us to have enjoy a good ride. And a lot of time, this relationship will last a lifetime. Unfortunately, my advisor passed away last year. But I think that his advisorship and also his friendship I cherish for many, many years. And I feel like I lost a good friend, I lost a good mentor. And sometimes I felt like I lost a lot of part of my life. And so I think that this relationship is really important. It would be really wonderful, you know, that after a few years or even after 10 years or 20 years after your PhD, when you talk to your advisor, they look at you just like their own kids, right? And then and they're really proud of what where you are. They really share happiness of your life. I think that is something that we all would cherish for a very long time. So yeah, I think that's just, I would say that really make sure you understand that we are really on the same boat and we're working towards driving this big boat to this unknown world, exploring together. Yeah, enjoy the ride. I think that's it. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Yan. That was very, very interesting and great advice. So Tristan, would you like to go next?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
Share screen. So I have to say, actually, while I'm trying to get the screen sharing set up, yeah, and I love the thing that you had said about being okay with not checking and accept reject is like a great litmus test for knowing when you're about to graduate. Mine was when I became very picky about swag at various events. I'm not sure I would pass yours still, unfortunately. So great. So hi, everyone. I'm Tristan Naumann. And today, I guess I'll be talking to you a bit about the journey that I had and a bit about how I'm diverging a bit from the questions that were put to us. So at a high level, I'm a principal researcher in the Health Futures Group at Microsoft Research. My research sort of sits at the intersection of machine learning and health broadly, but I specifically work quite a bit on biomedical and clinical natural language processing. And more generally, I guess, again, it just sort of how to reconcile sort of the complex, unstructured healthcare data about patients. I also, you know, beyond sort of the day-to-day that I do, serve in a bunch of other roles. I was recently program chair of the SIAM Conference on Health Imprints and Learning. I'm one of the co-chairs for NeurIPS workshops this year and have been co-chair for clinical NLP at a variety of ACL venues, but more broadly, just a bunch of other events as well. Before that, I was joking with some people before this started that, you know, as a PhD student in particular, I feel like there were often undergraduates who would ask me about, you know, experiences and life advice and things like that. And my go-to, honestly, was often to tell them to talk to my office mate at the time, because I feel like I had made a bunch of sort of haphazard decisions that had fortunately worked out, but not always in the way that, I didn't necessarily have sort of as structured a set of goals around where I wanted to be as many of the other people that I went to school with. So sort of just a quick recap of what I did. I actually started off doing more CS theory type work and worked for a few years between undergraduate and grad school, during which time I was a program manager on Windows and did absolutely nothing related to CS theory and absolutely nothing related to what I was going to do in the future. I had sort of decided at some point that I would apply to graduate schools and didn't really know at the time what I was going to be working on in particular. I sort of had a high level idea, but I think that probably, as anybody who has recently gone through PhD admissions probably knows, that that's increasingly rare, I think, to have something like that. I ended up joining, I sort of during the course of talking with various advisors, discovered that I really had this strong interest in healthcare and wanted to work on healthcare more than a lot of other things. And so I found myself working with the clinical decision-making group on a number of problems around clinical decision-making, but specifically how to use notes that are written about patients at the point of care in order to better predict things about them. And so I put this up, but I'm mostly telling you all of this because I think I'm asked a number of questions, you know, with relative frequency now about, you know, I'm currently in an industry position. I was sort of on the fence about industry and academia when I was graduating. So I'm asked a lot of questions about industry versus academia. I participate in a lot of sort of academic service and specifically a lot of things that involve organizing. So I often get a lot of questions about, you know, conference and workshop organization and how to best do it and how to do it at different venues and things like that. Because I am in industry, I'm often asked about interviewing. Because I've done a lot of peer review, I feel like I'm also often asked about peer reviewing. And as I'm sure everybody here knows, peer reviewing is one of those things you can talk about forever and never seems to necessarily get fixed. And then by a lot of, undergraduates primarily, of course, but occasionally some folks in industry who are looking to go back to grad school, a lot of questions about grad school applications, among other things. So I'm sort of highlighting these in part because if you find me later in the Gather Town or, set up something offline, I'm happy to answer questions about these or really anything else. And of course, a lot of questions about NLP because that's what I do and the other research that I do as well. So I had mentioned before, you know, I think there are a set of questions that were sort of posed to a few of us to think about. I went sort of a different track, and rather than answering some of those questions, I decided I was going to sort of come up with advice that I wish that I knew at the beginning of my PhD, and specifically things that I probably got wrong at the beginning of my PhD. So hopefully these are a good place to spur discussion. So the first PhD myth, let's say, that I had been thinking about was that a PhD is supposed to be hard. And if you're not like struggling through it, you're not doing it right, or you're not working hard enough or something like that. I think this is one of those things that I saw among a lot of peers, and I think it's really detrimental to mental health. And it's really one of those things that it just doesn't need to be that way. I mean, I'm not saying, of course, that a PhD is going to be easy, but I just don't think that we necessarily need to all buy into this sort of mindset of like shared suffering in which we're supposed to be really putting absolutely everything into it, especially, if you have families or anything, any other number of considerations in your life, there are a lot of things outside of a PhD that are equally important, if not more so. The second one is no one else is having a hard time. So I think this is something that took me a really, really long time to realize during my PhD. I think, you know, as you know, others were sort of mentioning about how they formed the ability to be robust to sort of rejection and a number of other things. I really I think it's so easy to get caught up in this idea that, you know, my paper just got rejected, for example, and I'm looking around and three of my peers got their papers accepted, and it's just me and nobody else is having a hard time. And maybe a corollary to that is really like, and I need to suffer through this alone. I think it's really important to have support, whether that's, you know, ideally a number of different support mechanisms, but, you know, whether that's peers or family or your advisor or, you know, whoever else to help support you through some of these things. But I think one of the things that's really important to acknowledge, and one of the things that I know I tried to do as a PhD student for some of the more junior PhD students in our lab, was like really acknowledge and call out when my papers were rejected so that they didn't feel like it's only their papers getting rejected, or when my experiments just didn't work. You know, it's the 11th hour and we're about to submit a paper and we get a negative result. And really trying to make it clear that it's not just you in a lot of these cases. Another thing that I wanted to sort of highlight that I think a lot of people I've heard say is, you know, either dropping out or taking time off is just some sort of failure, like that you should be innately robust to all of these things. And I didn't really believe that. Like I said, I had worked in between, and I think that experience was sort of centering for me and realizing that there is a lot to life. And, you know, if it's like, I had already left academia once, so it never really seemed that jarring if I was going to drop out again. But I think for a lot of people, it's really difficult to see that if you're sort of in this path that is, you know, I did a bachelor's, now I'm doing a master's, now I'm doing a PhD. Any divergence from that can be, you know, you might consider a failure, and it just really doesn't have to be that way. And actually, to one of the speakers' points from before, you know, there are a lot of reasons to leave and, you know, for example, start a startup. That's certainly not a failure. There are a lot of other things that you can sort of do in life. Another one is, my worth is my publication record, or maybe also like my citation count. I feel like I've heard, you know, one or other of those two things. And it's just absolutely not the case. It is, I understand when you're getting rejected as for a paper or something like that, it's difficult to see it. But I think one of the things that, especially in the context of machine learning more broadly, everybody just has these giant publication records now. And I think, you know, I remember actually, you know, hearing you either need, you know, a few papers, or actually you just need one really good paper. And I think what I'm realizing increasingly is, you know, that one really good paper does often end up outweighing that sort of volume of papers, in part because, you know, if I'm trying to remember what people are working on or what their sort of contributions have been, it's a lot easier for me to remember as a person what that one paper was rather than sort of the sum of, you know, five or six different papers. And, you know, I think this one is undebatable among this audience probably, but, you know, peer review is always right. Peer review is definitely not always right. You know, for a variety of reasons, but, you know, there are a lot of external factors that go into peer review, of course, as well. So, you know, I know I've had papers that were received quite well, but then end up being rejected because there's just not enough room at the conference and it was less on topic than some other set of papers. Or alternatively, there was a very similar paper that was submitted, you know, not similar enough that the two works can't coexist, but similar enough that only one of them was going to be accepted. And mine was the weaker of those two papers. So I think this is, you know, peer review is certainly not always right. Maybe a slightly more debatable one is that my advisor is always right. So I know a lot of, I've worked with a lot of mentees and people just in general who've sort of said, you know, I have this idea, but, you know, my advisor's telling me to do this thing, but I'm pretty sure I'm right. And you very well may be. I actually think this is one of those things where toward the end of your PhD, when you're realizing, you know, well, my advisor is sort of growing me into this position where, yes, they're always going to be my advisor, but they're also growing me into a peer in this sort of academic space. That disagreement is okay. And it's healthy too sometimes, right? And so I want to be clear, I'm not saying go out and disagree with your advisors just for the sake of disagreement. What I am saying is, you know, there's a few things that came up during my PhD where I said, I think, you know, this is how something's going to work. And my advisor said, you know, it's absolutely not going to work that way. Fortunately, he gave me the freedom to actually try it. And I was humbled several times and he was definitely right. But there are two or three times that, you know, I was right. And I think actually, those are some of the more interesting things that I got to work on, in part because those are actually the things that sort of changed not just the way that I saw the entire space, but also the way that he saw the space as well. And I think sometimes those are some of the most meaningful findings are the ones that are actually not well aligned with intuition, but you know, turn out to sort of expand and open new research directions as a result. I think the next one is that great researchers are great managers. And I have talked with a number of people in the past about this, but I think there's this sort of interesting thing that happens in many places. It's not just academia, but there's sort of this notion that because you did very good work, you're now going to be very good at managing a lab, for example. And the two of those are not actually often the same thing. There are people who are great managers who are actually not very good researchers, and vice versa. And so the thing that I really want to call out here is twofold. So the first one is, for all of you here, you know, if you are going into some role where you're effectively going to manage people, please spend some time learning how to manage people. And it doesn't have to be, you know, like a lot of the soft courses or anything else like that, that sort of emphasize, you know, it doesn't have to be like Harvard Business Review style management best practices or anything like that. But I mean, more in terms of just, you know, you're potentially going to go into a position where you have a number of PhD students, and, you know, you can sort of work everyone until they're burnt out, or there are a lot of different things that you can do that are not going to be optimal for you or for them in the long run. And so, you know, take into account how to actually manage people and help them prioritize. And then the other thing that I want to call out is, you know, I had heard stories of, you know, I really enjoyed working with my advisor, who's absolutely wonderful. I remember hearing stories about other advisors. I remember hearing stories from students who were very proud that they were the only person in the group that the advisor had not made cry. And that's horrible. That's not a good advising relationship. And I think it's just one of those things where, like I said, I think there's this often this idea that because you're a great researcher, you're going to be a great manager. And that is just definitely not always the case. I don't think that's really acceptable, regardless of sort of where you are. I think another one that comes up pretty frequently is sort of institution is more important than advisor. And I've heard this, and I want to acknowledge that there are caveats to this. There are things like if you're moving internationally, sort of what's the recognition of the school that you're at and all those sorts of things. But I think in general, you know, in a day-to-day sense, your advisor has so much bearing on your quality of life and, you know, the research directions that you're going to and be able to pursue, that it's often actually the opposite, that your advisor is going to have much more influence on, you know, your any number of daily and then any number of long-term aspects during the course of your PhD. And as several people have mentioned before, honestly, that relationship often is a very long-term relationship. And so I think it's much more important to get an advisor that you really identify with and you really click with, that you can see having that long-term relationship with over some of the other things like, I just want to be, you know, at this school, for example. One of the caveats, I say this knowing that I actually made decisions in my life about, you know, I just want to be in this geography. And that's also okay as well. Another thing is that chasing state of the art is important. And I don't want to say it's similar to maybe the number six here. I don't want to say that it's unimportant. I think many of us are aware that you're going to get called out in a review or something like that for not comparing to state of the art or something like that. But I do just want to acknowledge, you know, I think some of the most meaningful work is really some of the work that's done that's not just here's another incremental result that, you know, nudges an AUC or an AUPR by a few percentage points. Some of the things that really foundationally change the field are really truly the things that are just taking a different tack entirely. And I think what, you know, one of the things here that maybe is related is really, you know, that your work is sort of going to speak for itself as well. I think one of the things that was, maybe I'll come back to that one actually, but I think, you know, some of the most meaningful things that we end up working on are the ones that, you know, are related to or can be related to some of the current state of the art, but are just sort of coming at it from a different angle. Because I think sometimes a different viewpoint is really important in actually making, you know, a big leap forward in that space. And the last one that I wanted to talk to is sort of, you know, like this, this piece about academia, you know, I actually have heard both, I guess. I started off with this point being academia is a stable career. And then I realized, you know, I'd heard people say, well, like industry is a stable career. And I think, you know, to sort of Jan's point earlier, there are a lot of trade-offs. And I think it's just really important to acknowledge some of those trade-offs and maybe to spur discussion later and throw a sort of a jab. I think, you know, I want to also be cautious about sort of broad characterizations about what it means to work in industry or lab or academia or startups or whatever else, in part because, you know, I think the idea that things, you know, I'm an industry researcher, technically, I work in a very academic research lab, but, you know, I am in industry. And I think if I were, you know, only looking at like a 3 to 6 month horizon, I would probably not be doing my job very well. So I think, you know, it's really important to sort of understand wherever you are, whether it's, you know, academia or industry, what are sort of the trade-offs that you're making? And are you happy with some of those trade-offs as well? And, you know, I think you can sort of, this is a non-exhaustive list of myths. You can add, I'm sure, many, many more of your own. And I'd actually be really curious to hear what some others are. I know in listening to Pravi's talk earlier, I actually, the one of the ones that I probably should have identified was this myth that your work will just speak for itself. It is really important, in fact, to sort of actually go out and evangelize and talk about your work because, you know, if you come out with a paper that's related, you know, PNP or something like that, yes, it's probably going to get a lot of attention and it will probably speak for itself. But barring some of those sort of really, really sort of grand findings, it is really important to actually advocate for your own work. And maybe another one from that talk as well is, you know, this myth that I can't really ask for help. It's actually really important that you ask for help. It's one of those things where even to this day, you know, I know that I often have characterized a PhD in finding out how many things I'm not an expert in, because I think, you know, during the course of my PhD, at least, I constantly was finding out, you know, even as I think I really understand something, there's someone just down the hall or somebody that I can send an email to who not only understands that topic better than I do, but understands everything about that topic better than I do. And it almost always made a lot of sense to ask them for help rather than try to just rediscover it on my own, because the insight that they can convey is so much more meaningful in terms of actually forming a really informed opinion about something, but then also, you know, not just redoing the work that they've sort of done to get to the same place. So yeah, I guess that's a handful of, you know, PhD myths. Like I said, I'd love to hear some of yours as well, because I think there are just many more. And look forward to the discussion and talking with some of you later.
Thank you so much, Tristan. Very, very cool and interesting. Really, really glad to hear that. So Neil, would you like to go next? All right, take it away.
Sure. Is this the right screen? Can you guys see this?
Yeah, it's the right one.
Excellent. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So thanks, Miguelis and Joyce and everyone else here. I'm actually, I think this is fortuitous that like the talks were organized this way, because I think mine is probably most related to Tristan's as compared to some of the earlier talks, and that it's really just going to be kind of about different things, different aspects of the experience, like while you're undergoing a PhD, I suppose, useful tidbits during that time. So yeah, a little bit about me. So I did my undergrad at NC State, which is a state school in North Carolina. And at the time I started working a little bit on research on data indexing, compression, and systems applications. And this was kind of my first foray into research. I quickly realized that wasn't super fun and I didn't really like that area as much, although I really enjoyed research. And so eventually I ended up pursuing a PhD at Carnegie Mellon, which is where I met Gellis and you know, a bunch of other great folks And I started working in the space of data mining and so small work analysis, now IR detection specifically. And you know, recently, as of the last three and a quarter years, I've been working at Snapshot as a research scientist. And I've kind of continued on the path of data mining, machine learning, and mostly graph-based machine learning. So I think that's a little bit of context. So I'm on the industrial research side. I guess a little bit about my PhD experience. I mean, these are all meant to be like happy pictures or happy memories for me. I got to give some really great talks. I got to celebrate like very important moments in my life, you know, in the middle top, that's kind of right after my defense. The middle bottom, you know, I think it's it's stashed away somewhere, but I remember when I got it, it was really important to me. The bottom left is a picture from KDD 2015 in Sydney, I believe, with Vigelis on the right. I met, my current partner. I found a new hobby in powerlifting. So that's one of my competitions at the time. I got to intern in some really great places, including MSR and Twitch and Lawrence Livermore. A search of acceptances in my email at the time that I was first making this talk, I think, which was a few years ago. Was quite a few. So it was filled with great memories. In addition to that, there were all of these memories, which perhaps, you know, you may not have seen if you knew me. Maybe Vigel saw some of those, but because we were friends, but I think these were mostly things that I also think about when I think about the PhD. And it's kind of just a lot of self-doubt, a lot of confusion about like what I was doing, whether I was good at what I was doing, how much worse I was, you know, what I was doing than everyone else that was doing it around me, and just generally being tired, pushed by deadlines, very cold in Pittsburgh where I did the PhD, and I also had a bunch of rejections in my inbox as well. So this is kind of, you know, the side that I'm sure most of you also live, but you know, maybe don't hear about as much. Although that is the theme of today. So I think it's fitting with what everyone else said. So my point is pretty much that, you know, the PhD is kind of, you kind of have this expectation of like, like Jan mentioned, you know, you've continued to excel in your previous endeavors, your previous iterations of school, and you kind of feel like you're gonna continue on this natural path. And in reality, there's not really a natural path. And I suppose maybe in retrospect, you can call that path natural. Because you know how unnatural it is, it's supposed to be, but when you're going through it, you really feel like it's kind of the worst jumble of things that's happened to you. I'm just going to give you a little bit of advice from my perspective. It's pretty much just many weekly organized lessons that I wish someone had told me, but that I had to learn the hard way instead. And in other words, it's going to be a lot like your PhD thesis and probably mine too. I think my goal here is that I'm going to say a bunch of things that are now obvious to me that were not so obvious at the time, but sometimes I really think you just need to hear something obvious from someone else to realize that it's obvious yourself. So I think that's kind of going to be the goal here. So I'm going to kind of divvy up the lessons here a little bit into like productivity, communication, and self-care. I think these are three really key components to getting through. Regarding productivity, I would start with this exercise of like redefining what you call productive. And I know I had this problem at the beginning of grad school where I was very used to measuring productivity in terms of a number of assignments delivered, amount of code that I wrote, how much like my grades, and you don't really have this in your PhD, right? You kind of have like weak reactions from your advisor, from people around you, from conference accepts and rejects. And you kind of like look for some meeting in that supervision. In terms of like, you know, how good you're doing or how productive you are. But in reality, productivity is not like always tangible. And this is especially true for the PhD. It's certainly not always seemingly positive. Like Tristan mentioned, you know, sometimes like you're just littered with negative results. And, in a way that is actually quite productive, although, you're certainly not going to see it that way right before paper submission. And certainly it's not constant. You know, this is a kind of a comic I remember looking at a few years ago from PhD comics, but this is kind of about like a grad student workout put over time, over the week, obviously like, you know, highly varying with different things that are happening and going on in your life outside the PhD. And this is totally normal and you should expect that. Second thing, going closely with productivity, reading. Time spent reading is not time wasted. It's actually very productive time. If you don't read, then you're gonna find it very hard to learn new content, which is a crux of most of your PhD experience. Finding new problems to work on, this is especially important. I mean, maybe right now as you're a student, different advisors have different guidance on this, but sometimes you're given problems, but other times in your future, if you're an advisor or if you're research and industry, or if you're at a lab, if you're actually driving research, you need to come up with ways of thinking about problems, right? And coming up with the problems, the right problems that people should be working on. And if you don't read, you're going to find it pretty hard to find out what these new problems are, how well they've been solved by previous work. You're going to get a lot of submissions that, where people just say that you should cite a bunch more papers in your related work, and that's good for no one. So, and lastly, becoming a better writer. So this is something that I find really important. I think a lot of students are not trained to be like good scientific writers early on. And, a lot of people think that the PhD being a scientific degree is really just about like doing rigorous science. But in reality, it's also about presenting your work very well to others, presenting this rigorous work in a rigorous way, I suppose. I think by reading good papers, you really learn to appreciate what good writers do that makes you like those papers. And if you can adopt those same tendencies, you're going to improve your chances of writing good papers and getting them accepted and getting good visibility for them. Doing internships. So internships, I did one almost every summer of my degree, right? Except for the last summer, to prepare for my defense. But internships are a really great opportunity to learn about what makes you happy. I chose to lead with this point because like some of the previous presenters said, a lot of figuring out what to do afterwards is about like being honest with yourself, about understanding like what your motives are, what your priorities are, and like, is the thing that you're going to do, actually gonna satisfy those motives? And if it's not, if you intrinsically have this misalignment, you're gonna be unhappy and you're gonna move on to something else. Pressure from others about like the prestige of professorship or the prestige of an industrial lab or whatever, these are kind of all meaningless in the face of your own happiness. Networking and making friends, this is really important. I mean, every summer you go and you intern somewhere and you meet a bunch of people from, across the country, across the world. And eventually you all scatter and now you have friends, everywhere. It's kind of like how mushroom spores fly along the wind and grow. So I think this is really important. You get a really easy in to build my network. And also you get a mental break from school. I mean, if you're really struggling with some projects at school, you're kind of burnt out from like the monotony of working on the same project day to day. An internship is a really good kind of way to throw a wrench into that and kind of force you to think about a new fresh problem that can sometimes be reinvigorating. Practical advice for this, you should apply early, usually October to December of the previous year. Reach out directly to people, expend your time and interest in making clear like what your alignment to the internship actually is. I can say this for myself, but I'm sure many other people get emails, asking for internships and collaborations and whatnot. The important thing is really to be earnest in your request. If you're getting a lot of your requests denied, it may not be that you're an unqualified candidate, but it might just really be that you haven't done the diligence in actually trying to make it clear for the person who's reading your email why they should choose you over anyone else. And that's really something that is kind of on you to make that effort to actually try to find the alignment for this other person. Communication. So this was something that Tristan actually mentioned, and I totally echo. So you should really try to do your work justice. This idea that the work speaks for itself, this is a very misleading idea. I found this meme on the right-hand side. The top part is quite relevant to the way I think about this, but in reality, like when you write a good paper, for that paper to actually receive the justice that you think it does, or that you think it should, people need to find that paper. People need to actually bother wanting to read the paper. And then they need to internalize, whatever you've presented. In reality, although your work might be very good, if no one ever finds it because of, you haven't done diligence in actually presenting it, advocating it, you know, putting it out there on your website, making it open access, typesetting it well so that people want to read it, organizing the story well, and so on. You know, your work is just going to kind of lie in the cesspool of, you know, the vast abyss of old unpublished or old published work. And so if you don't want it to be there, you actually need to take some steps to correct that. And carefully presenting this work, you know, maximizes like due diligence in reviewing. So like Jan mentioned, sometimes the best insight to take away from a reviewer is, you know, who missed a point, you know, who actually made a comment that you didn't include something in the paper that you should have. This is really kind of perhaps on you for maybe not presenting it as a key point, and making it clear such that a reviewer could actually find that point easily. And so, you know, I think that's the takeaway there. It also maximizes how likely your audience is to pay attention to what you're saying, whether you land opportunities or don't. You know, in giving job talks, this is certainly important. Networking at conferences. So you should go to conferences. I realize it's a bit hard right now, and fortunately you guys are all doing the right thing coming to this, I guess, since we're giving this at a conference. But conferences are a great opportunity to make friends and acquaintances. Avoid isolating yourself. I remember my first conference was in, I think my first data mining conference was in 2013 or something. I think it was ICDM. And at the time I didn't even work in the data mining field. I was just presenting on behalf of someone else. And I remember I knew nobody and I just sat in my hotel room and I ordered Domino's and I ate pizza. And it was like the most wasted experience that I remember. And I really regret that now. So, you know, if you're a student, you should go to these conferences. You should try to actively network and remember that research is a team sport. You know, you don't do everything by yourself. And so you need these collaborators, co-authors, and connections, you know, to find your next job, to eventually hire good students, good interns, and so on. And remember that the community is kind of small. I mean, it's growing, obviously, at a fast pace, but you're going to see a lot of these people for many years to come in the future. And, you know, the same way that I've you know, seen a bunch of the people on the panel here, as well as some of the attendees, I've seen you at like numerous conferences in the past. You know, I expect that fully to continue. And so remember that like the impressions that you're making are going to be continued, you know, and many people are going to remember those things in future years. And lastly, I just kind of want to touch a bit on self-care. So this is a fairly important point. And I think Tristan did really great due diligence to this, but I think a lot of this is very hard to do when you're a student, but really I think it's easier when you're able to improve your frame of reference about like what it is to be a student. And then specifically a PhD student. Firstly, it's very normal to feel ignorant about things during your PhD, and especially afterwards. And this was, you know, frankly, like, you know, as someone who has like dealt with imposter syndrome personally, you know, intensely in the past and still continues to do so, I think really it's important to be comfortable with the idea that you don't know the answers to most things. And, you know, really, really senior scientists and people that you probably respect, this is also true for them. And you know, that's, I think most of the PhD is just getting used to the territory of feeling stupid and not knowing what you're doing is correct. And that's kind of your happy place. It becomes your happy place. You know, peer comparisons, PhDs, like remember that your degree is all about specialization, right? So criticizing yourself for your inability to understand or reproduce the work of your office mate, or your other students in your department or in the field, it's very normal, and yet it's like highly arrogant, because you know, you're kind of just assuming that like you can pick up, say, something that your theory office mate did, you know, through, you know, due to their years of experience in computer science theory, and you know, just because you read their paper and you can't figure out how they came up with these derivations, and you know, you can't figure out how come their paper looks so much better and fancier and nicer than yours. That's totally normal. And, you know, realize that they're probably saying the same thing about your paper. So most of you, you know, may be familiar with the Dunning-Kruger effect idea. The general idea is portrayed in the bottom right, that, you know, there's kind of this relationship between competence and confidence. And in general, most of you are probably on this concave part of the curve right now. And, you know, probably will be for quite a long time. But, you know, realize that this is very normal. This is a documented effect. I mean, you know, you're gaining competence during your PhD years, but of course your confidence is going to like decline as you realize and correct your frame of reference that like, you know, the community is much bigger and much larger and much more complex than you thought it was. And that's totally natural. and having a life. So other folks touched on this probably especially, but the PhD is not just a start to, but it's also part of the rest of your life. You know, you want to remember that it's like 4 or 5 years, for some people, 6, 7, 8, you know, maybe more. You want to use the time to pick up hobbies. You want to build relationships. Don't forget that you're also a human being, like in the time that, you know, this is a significant chunk of your life. So don't waste it just by doing the PhD, but, you know, remember that you have other things in life to optimize for, right? Importantly, this is super, super important for me. So I'm actually, I think this is maybe one of my last points, is compartmentalizing other parts of your life from work. So for me, I had many, many bad days or many days during the PhD where I just felt like I accomplished nothing. And compartmentalizing is really good in that I, you know, my routine during my PhD was often to, you know, work for a few hours, but then I would frequently go to the gym. I would go to the gym almost every day. And sometimes like doing something good at the gym was totally enough to offset like a bad day that I had, you know, in terms of like not producing anything or not getting any good work done. And so remember that like your mental health is like also a function of other parts of your life and other good things that are happening rather than just, you know, how good or bad your work days are going. And so it's important to be able to create these avenues where you can find wins for yourself when all else seems lost. And lastly, avoid over-allocating your identity on your academic prowess. Like just to mention, you know, number of papers, whatever. This is like, yeah, I mean, it's a bunch of academic metrics, which, you know, we convince ourselves kind of matters, but, you know, remember that that's not really all you are as a person. And yeah, life doesn't end with a PhD. So it's just the start to the rest of your career. It's a crucial milestone, but don't lose sight of what comes after. And what you do from here is up to you. You could do postdocs, professorships, industry, both like engineering as well as research, government lab, startup, something totally different. This is also entirely acceptable, by the way. Like some people just get a PhD and then realize that, you know, that was like not a good use of time and they just wanted to do something else instead. And that's totally fine. That's acceptable, right? You know, you don't have to live your life through the pressures of like other people's expectations of what you do once you get a PhD. Thanks. Thank you for indulging me. And feel free to email me with questions, comments, if you're interested in future opportunities and whatever. Here's my email, my website, and Snap Research. Thank you.
Thank you, Neil. Really cool slides also. Now, Jillian, would you like to go next?
It seems I can only share the screen now. Oh, yes, I can. Okay, thanks Wiggles and Joyce for this invitation. On the one hand, I feel very excited to share some of my experiences and opinion. On the other hand, I feel a little bit nervous because I'm so concerned that my experiences and opinions will mislead some others. So if you have different opinions, we can discuss after that. I would like to introduce myself a little bit. I got my bachelor degree, master degree from the same university from Beijing in 2008 and 2010 respectively. And then I got my PhD from Arizona State in 2015. After that, I spent 1.5 years at Yahoo Labs and then came back to academia at MSU until today as assistant professor. So today, I would like to discuss a few items in the panel. The first item I want to discuss is if I go back to my PhD life again, what kind of advices I would give to myself? So the first advice I want to give myself is I want to volunteer more. I didn't realize this advice until I observed my student did a lot of volunteer works. And they learned a lot while they keep the productivities in research. Certainly, there are so many opportunities we can be a volunteer. So in the university, we can give some volunteer lectures and mentorship. And I think my students did well. They organized every semester. So we organized a seminar about introduced scale to engineering. And also, of course, we can be volunteers in conferences, some social events like job fairs, and so on. Obviously, we can learn a lot from this volunteer work. We can make a lot of connections, make sometimes if we make lifelong friends, we can learn a lot of skills and like social skills, communication skills, and we also can gain career experience. For example, so if you want to be a faculty in the future, so you can talk to the, so there's typically a session, you can talk to the faculty candidates. So in this way, you can learn the path and also learn some experiences. Of course, if you feel tired on research, we can have fun by doing volunteer works. So the second, so during my PhD study, I'm very struggling in making choices. For example, which is a research topic I should do, A, B, C, or D. So when I should have intern, where, and who I should intern with. And of course, when you graduate, you are struggling in academia and the industry. I think I make this process too complicated. I can make it much more simple. For example, I spend months to decide I should go to industry or academia. Eventually, I first go to Yahoo, and then I go back to MSU. I feel both experiences are valuable. I don't waste any time. The only time I waste is struggling to make the decision for several months. So I would suggest myself to make the process much simpler and just do it. And so the third advice I want to give myself is I try to keep my hobbies. Before my PhD, I have quite a few hobbies. For example, the Chinese calligraph. I also do some two-string instrument. I play Chinese chess very frequently. During the PhD, I feel I'm too busy. I don't have spare time. I should give up those hobbies. And then probably I may pick them up after graduation because I thought what I will have is like after grad. So in this figure, x-axis is the years and y-axis is my spare time. I thought after graduate, I should get more spare time. So then I can pick up those hobbies. But what is really happening is like this. When I graduate, I started a new career, busy. And then when I want to go back to academia, I start a new career, even busy. And last year I get a new baby, no spare time. So don't wait. So even you are busy for your PhD, keep your hobbies. That's very important. I mean, it's lifelong. So the second item I want to discuss is about how can we handle rejection? I want to present several facts about rejection. So the first fact I want to say is rejection is common. Let me demonstrate. I just list a few top conferences in our field about their acceptance rate. So we can say it's between 13% to 20%. And also the acceptance ratio decreases have the trend. And we always, people always tell us the acceptance ratio, but then we ignore a lot of fact. What's the rejection ratio? We can do a very simple calculation. We can get the rejection ratio. If the acceptance ratio is 20%, that means that the rejection ratio is 8%. That means 4 out of 5 papers will get rejected. So if your acceptance ratio is 13%, so that means the rejection ratio is 87%. That means 6 out of 7 papers will get rejected. So that means, so all those factors tell us rejection is very common. So the second thing factor I want to share is rejection doesn't mean bad quality. Okay, so probably we have this kind of experiences. A lot of influential papers in our field, they just got in after several rejections. So here, I also want to show one example did by ISOLR. They called the ISOLR Best Rejected Paper Award. So this is some paper from 2017 rejected by ISOLR. We can say later on, they get into other conferences, they're quite influential. So the thing is, how can we treat the reviews, the rejection reviews? So my third advice could be, we need to be positive. So once we can be positive, and then we can calm down emotionally, and then we can really take a look at the reviews. And of course, we are always biased. The papers are our babies. Our babies are always perfect. We like them, we love them. So the reviewers must misunderstand them, right? So that's why it's very hard for us to not be biased to look at those reviews. So sometimes I will ask my friends to read the paper and read the feedback. So those feedback are constructive or destructive. Always, I mean, we get some very good constructive comments. So then the second thing we want to do is we need to understand why. Why the paper get rejected? It's because of the presentation. The motivation is not clear. It's about the methods, lack novelty, or we need to improve the methods, or it's about the experiments. So we need to understand why, because the most important thing we get from rejection is our next steps. So how can we improve the paper, right? What lessons we learned, we can apply to the next paper. So basically what I want to say is sometimes rejection or acceptance may mean win, but rejection doesn't mean we lose. It means we learn, we can learn from those rejections to get ready for our next papers. And the third item I want to discuss is networking with senior mentors. I think I'm so fortunate to have the opportunities to work with senior mentors during every stage of my career. Something I realize is those senior people are just a life book. So reading good book always can make us smart. So from those senior mentors, I learned a lot, like their life experiences, the version which can make me look further. And one thing I always doing is I'm asking for fish. I don't ask for the fish. So that means, so there's an old saying from China, philosophy Lao Tzu. So give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Teach a man how to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. So that means if we just ask a fish, we just get a fish. If we ask for the fishing, we learn how to fish. We can catch a lot of fish in the future. I also would like to give one example during my PhD. It's my first paper, okay? So I spent 1 year to prepare this paper. And so this is the first version, I got it. So it even doesn't look like a paper, right? So the title is not good, the figure is ugly, and the introduction is, I even don't want to read it again. So I look at my advisor, I don't send the link to say, hey, so Juan, give me some, so please advise, give me the perfect paper. No, I printed out, I locked at the door of my advisor, and I said, Juan, can you give me some suggestions about this shape of paper? So where I can improve, and how to improve, and why? Okay, so my advisor is very nice. He gave me some feedback, and then I get the first version. We have a good title. I have an abstract, and also the logic of the introduction becomes better. And then I did the same thing again and again, and this is the final version, right? So we have a very nice figure, and the logic is much clearer, and everything seems much better. So from this paper, I'm not just get a paper, I get how to write a paper. So in fact, this is the only paper my advisor helped me revise heavily. After that, typically only a few minor suggestions, the paper is ready to submit. So that's why it's so important to ask for the fishing, not a fish. And the final item I would like to discuss is the navigation advisor and advisee relations. So one thing I think we have is we, the students, and the advisor and as a YZ, they have different expectations, right? So the advisor's expectation here and the students here. So it's definitely a mismatch. So how can we align our expectation together with the advisor and as a YZ? I think the first step we want to do is we can work out the plan. So what's the plan? We can have the plan for the semester, for the year, for your whole PhD career, or even after your PhD graduation, right? So of course, adjusting the plan is a part of the plan. We always can adjust. So the second thing I think other panelists discussed is the communication. So good communications always can make good things. So we need to communicate with our, can communicate with advisee timely and properly. So we know the advisor, advisors might be busy in a lot of things. So sometimes a friend remind is necessary to, hey, it's a friend remind, I have an email, wait for your response. And also advisor here, sometimes we provide help. So feel free to ask questions and also making requests necessary. And finally, I think we also need to be aware of some boundaries. So we are talking about the advisor and advisee relationships. Definitely we are dependent, right? We are not totally independent. But on the other hand, to graduate, we need to show some independence. So we have to be clear about the boundary, about dependence, when, where, and what we should be independent and what we should be dependent. And of course, so during our PhD life, the advisor will play multiple roles in our life, friend, advisor, and the collaborators. We also need to clear about the boundaries. I think that's pretty much what I want to share today. So as I mentioned at the beginning, so this is just my own experiences and opinions. So if you have different opinions, we can discuss. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tilian. Really, really cool talk. And thank you all panelists for really, really interesting, insightful talks and a lot of great points raised. So I'm not sure if in 15 minutes the Zoom will collapse, but let's proceed with questions from the audience. And if it collapses, let's, you know, the plan is to move to gather downtown and do an informal sort of meet and greet there. So you can find the link to that on the VFairs platform. If you just go to the main hall, the coffee break room, that's where you was going to be. And so I'm just telling everybody in case, you know, we would get disconnected. All right. So do we have any questions from the audience for anything for any of the panelists or any points? Please feel free to unmute yourself and ask. Don't be shy, the first one.
I have one question.
Yes, please go ahead.
It's a starting camera here. Especially to the ones working at either national labs or in industry, and as a researcher or a scientist in that sense, how do you ensure that you're also publishing work that you do in your daily work life? Is that part of any, I don't know, just thinking about any KPI or something that you have to publish, or is it in your personal interest? I'd like to hear about that.
Can I go, Vagelis?
Sure, yeah, go ahead.
Joyce. So I think one of the, it depends upon the place that you end up working. For example, if you're on the classified site, there are many interesting research that never gets published at all. Okay, that's the another practical reality, either because of unavailability of time or that doesn't allow you to publish and things like that, right? When it comes to the case of National Lab, when you are on the open side, one of the expectation is to publish. So it's one of your yearly evaluation for metric. So in the National Lab, depending upon where you are, there is a high probability that publishing is one of the evaluation metrics.
Cool. I'll jump in also. So again, I'm in a pretty academic industrial research lab, but I think one of the things that, to short circuit the answer, yes, I do continue to publish, and I am absolutely incentivized to publish. I think there are a handful of things that are sort of interesting about publication. So it's changed the way that I look at publications. I think as a grad student in particular, I was sort of, you know, publication was sort of the primary thing that I was doing. And so I was very focused on, you know, trying to publish, which actually was sort of a poor match for me because I never really was very interested in just like trying to pump out papers. I was much more interested in like working on cool projects, whether or not that led to publication. And so I think in, at least in my current role, I feel like it's often the case that I get to work on cool projects. And if we want to publish them, we can. And if we don't want to, there's not as much pressure to publish them, which is sort of a nice balance. I tend to also just be sort of on the open side of things. So to the extent that we can give away code models, you know, pretty much whatever else, I try pretty hard to do it, so long as I'm not stepping on somebody else's toes by giving away their code or their models or something like that. Cool, Neil, do you want to go?
Yeah, sure. I think I really agree there. I mean, I think the perception on publication changes the more time you spend in industry. And certainly, you know, I think Snap, from what I understand, is it's a little bit also more on kind of a industrial slash academic lab. I mean, in that we get a lot of flexibility in terms of publishing, and it's actually encouraged. So in that sense, it's good. I mean, I think certainly if you want to publish and you start off working at a place that you understand doesn't have a great culture on publishing or doesn't want to publish, then you should kind of try to suss that out before going to work at that place. I think certainly once you're, if you're actually at a place that does encourage publishing and does allow it, then I think the more interesting piece at that point is trying to like figure out, like trying to make part of your responsibility, understanding how you can take problems that other people in the business have that don't perhaps have a publication goal, and trying to make them research problems in and of itself. I think some of that is just understanding that, you know, you're going to work with many people at a company, and some of them don't care about publishing. That's just the reality of it. But they have very interesting problems, and you might realize that those are instances of research problems. You might realize that those are extensions or corner cases of problems. And nowadays, I mean, you know, conferences for example, KDD and DubDubDub, for example, have application tracks where you can kind of focus a little bit more on applied problems that have a little bit more of the reality component to, you know, working with research and industry. So certainly I think your job changes a bit to figuring out like what the right scope of translating a business problem to a publication should be.
I think maybe it's just like one quick follow-up also. If you're in a position where you're interviewing or you're going through the process of like accepting a job somewhere, just be clear about your desire to continue publishing. I know I actually had I have a friend who had been sort of barred from publishing. And so I'd asked about that during the job interview that I was doing. And, you know, I got a reasonably honest answer, but it also, that answer also made it pretty clear that that was not a good fit for me, because I was still interested in publishing. And the sort of unequivocal answer was, you could, but, and then a whole bunch of different things that were sort of gates to publication. And I sort of, at least for myself, I had decided I didn't ever really want to be put in a position where my ability to publish was gated by, you know, marketing or business development or a bunch of these other considerations.
Great, thank you. Any other question from the audience? So if there's no question, let me just do the session chariot, and, as Neil says. And I mean, often many of you touched on this, but it's often neglected in sort of the larger scheme of things in the curriculum, sort of the mental health aspect of things and sort of staying grounded and kind of like maintaining a life and so on, right? So, some of the talks touched on this, but maybe I feel it's very important to kind of reiterate, and maybe if you have any sort of nuggets of wisdom on how you stay grounded, how you kind of like maintain, you know, a life beyond being identified by the work and so on. Please, whoever wants to go first, you know, just go ahead. No, don't be shy now.
As Jillian explained in the slide, it's not in your control, right? you need to honor your commitments, and free time gets down, right? So so as time goes in, even a small break will be a very rich, meaningful break, right? So that's the way that we can think about it. For example, when you are given 10 Snickers, it may not make a difference to you, but only when you have only half Snickers in life, then you cherish that taste, right? So I think all of us will have that bandwidth, but as Jan mentioned, we should honor our commitments. And at the same time, as rest of the people mentioned, you must have your own me time as well. Apart from the family time, also make sure that you have a me time, right? For example, Friday, 10 to 1 is my time, right? Like, family understands that, they respect that time, and they let me with my own time. I do anything like playing games, watching movies, or anything that I want to do. They will not come near me at that time, right? So, yeah, so you will, there is, I still remember that YouTube video where the professor says, like, it's the order and the priority that you put in that you can put more and more things into your jar. That is, when you put a lot of pebbles, you will feel like there is nothing in your life. And then when you start adding sand, and he keeps on adding it, and finally he will still have a space to add the beer, right? So you always have time to have beer with your friends. So I think that's the way you have to see the life.
Thank you, Ramki.
I just want to.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry. Is someone going? Oh, Tristan, you want to go?
Oh, no. Go ahead.
Okay, sure. Sorry about that. I was just going to say, like, I think part of this is also that, you know, if you're in a role that you're advising students, or if you're working with students or interns, like, I think everyone sees. Everyone finds, or everyone decides what they think is important based on what people that they respect think is important. And as a student, you know, who's working with an advisor, you kind of see like where they place their priorities and where they place their time. And as an intern, you know, perhaps it's the same thing. And certainly it's true for me even now that I have a PhD, and, you know, I still have mentors. I still have people I respect. And, you know, I look to them for guidance on how to organize and navigate my own life. But I think that it's important, if you're in one of these positions, that, you know, you have people working under you or working, you know, on projects that you're leading, that you kind of show them by example what you expect and what you prioritize. You know, if they constantly see you working all the time and never spending time with, you know, their family, or you know, pursuing their hobbies, or entertaining any of these other aspects of life, you know, I think you're maybe not explicitly authorizing it, but you're effectively creating this kind of environment where they don't feel comfortable doing those things, because they see that, you know, successful people like you don't do those things. And so I think part of it is just like being cognizant of doing that, you know, even if it's just for show for the people that are working with you.
So I'm happy you mentioned that, in part because I was going to tell a bit of a story that emphasizes that. I remember during my PhD, I was working on a project where there was actually quite a time crunch, and I did not do a good job of modeling taking time off, in part because we were all sort of racing toward a deadline. And one of the results was that one of the students that I was working with on this particular paper had sent me this series of, you know, like panics text messages the night of the deadline, saying, you know, look, I don't think that I can write this section anymore. I don't think, you know, I'm it's just going to be really tough, but I might be able to in about an hour. And I had sort of taken a moment and said, you know, is everything all right? What's going on? And he sort of revealed during part of this that he had a relative that was now in the hospital in an unexpected way, and that he was planning on trying to do the writing from the hospital. And I remember just saying, please do not, like, please, you, this is just a paper. Like, honestly, if we miss this deadline, it doesn't even matter that much. Like, big picture, it just doesn't make that much of a difference. Years out from now, you're going to remember the hospital part. You're not going to remember the paper, most likely. And at the very least, you know, I can probably write that section too. Like, it's not, you know, sure, I'm going to be up an hour later. Like, it doesn't really matter in the big picture. And I think I realized, actually, you know, one of the pieces there that I realized was modeling the behavior is incredibly important, in part because I think the reason that he probably didn't feel great about taking the time off is because he could see that I was just sort of like waking up and working on this until I went to sleep for several days in a row, trying to make sure that we were gonna hit the target deadline. And that's not good for anyone, really.
Thank you, Tristan. Probably you
I think Tristan is making a very important point. Understand that all the people around you are also rational, right? So you can always say when you cannot meet a deadline or when you're unable to contribute something, people understand, accept, and you don't need to feel bad about it, right? So as mentioned, like as everyone mentioned, you as a human and you as your life is much more important than research or papers, right? So
I'm a fairly new PhD student, and like 2 years ago, and I was a postdoc for a year where I still felt like I was a student, and I became staff, I think, January 2020, which is still fairly new than a lot of people on this panel. So one of the things I had was when I came out of grad school, I was defining myself as like, what is Pravi, or who I am as a person. And until that time, because as part of this grad school community, I was able to define myself as, I'm a PhD student. And it was so much more easier to define. And now that I'm working among scientists, and a lot of them have kids and like are married, and I moved from Southern California to Tennessee, which I really did not know anyone. So I was trying to suddenly find hobbies and really realize beyond work, who am I? So one of the things I did, I took the hard part about moving from grad school to here is like in grad school, you can work anytime. Nobody's putting, at least not my experience, like there was no like you have to go into the lab, especially being in computer science, you have to go into the lab at this time and be out at this time. So it was easier to do my work anytime. So I would preferably work on a weekend and not work on a Friday. So that's how I've done it. So coming out, it was very hard for me to not check my email or not work on a weekend. And then one of the things I did, I started running, I started walking, and then I started finding friends, basically a hiking meetup group. So like it's a lot. You just have to learn to identify things and try a lot of different things to identify what you are beyond your grad school experience or beyond your PhD. And that also takes a lot of time and force yourself to take a break and not think about work. And that for me, it was like a good transition period. That being a postdoc was being from like going to grad school where there was no boundaries of when I can and cannot work or constantly meeting deadlines to coming into a work life. I had to change my mindset of like, oh yeah, okay, it's a weekend. Everyone is not going to work. So I'm not going to check my email on a Sunday, even though I am bored and I'm not used to not working on a Sunday. So it's you have to really put that effort into not working, unlike whatever people might say. And that's fine, explore your hobbies. And even if I listen to a lot of audiobooks, especially during the pandemic. I normally do too, but especially during the pandemic, I walk an hour every day, like usually an hour in the evening or 20 minutes in the morning because I have a dog too now. So just try to find lots of podcasts too. Just try to find a lot of things that interest you. Explore a lot of things and you might like them or you might not like them, but also try to find who am I really beyond being a PhD student or beyond a doctoral researcher. So.
Thank you. Thank you, Pravi. So I'm told that we have only a couple minutes left before the Zoom disconnects. So what I suggest is for whomever can make it, let's all jump into gather.town and we can sort of gather around and have a similar kind of interaction there that does not need to be moderated by me, but it's a little bit more free flow. So if you cannot make it, then thank you so much for sticking around this long. And thank you for being part of this awesome panel, either as an attendee or a panelist. And looking forward to the poster session tomorrow. So see you all hopefully at the gather.